appreciate the presence of the Lord tonight. So sweet. Amen. Sweet to trust in Jesus. Sweet to rest in His presence. Amen. Go look at the book of Acts again tonight. Pray that all is going well for all the young people that are in school. I'm thinking about you. Praying for you. Trust in the Lord to bless you this year. I want to bounce back, not too far, and I never know exactly how far I'm going to go. I think just up into part of chapter number 9 is my plans tonight. Want to look at just a few things. I'm jumping back there to the book of Acts, chapter number 8, and we have not finished up the whole chapter. But we've looked at several things which happened there as we finished up in chapter 7, Stephen being the first martyr, being stoned. We looked at Philip going down to the city of Samaria, and he preached Jesus Christ unto them. And the Bible says that people gave heed to the things which he preached. Amen. Especially when they saw the miracles which were done. And those who were possessed with demons were set free. Those who were sick of palsy, those who were lame, that were healed. Amen. Thank God that he's the healer. Amen. Oh God, we need to see more of the move of the Spirit of God, and where lives are healed, it brings glory to God, it gives evidence to Him and His authority. And the Bible says that there was that sorcerer there, and he had quite the following of individuals. Sorcery is of the devil. I think we even have to be careful even when we look at today. Folks do sleight of hands, folks, magic, and just need to be careful. Just need to be careful. And we certainly don't want to ever give a foothold to the enemy, do we? And so we see that going on down to the chapter, I want to jump to verse number 18. And the Bible says, when Solomon saw through the laying on of hands that of the apostles, and that the Holy Ghost was given, there was something that he saw. And although it's not written out here, we look at other places in the Word of God. We look at Acts 2:4, Acts 10:48, that there is that signed evidence of the Holy Ghost. And what is that? Amen. That's exactly all right, Brother David. As the Spirit of God gives utterance, speaking in other tongues. And the Bible says in verse number 19 that he said, saying, give me also this power, that whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. Amen. That is not anything that can be purchased with money.
Amen.
Amen. It is a gift of God. Amen. Thank God for the gift of the Holy Ghost tonight. Amen. Thank God that He gives to us when we ask of Him. Amen. And Peter said, your money perish with you because you have thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Amen. It's not for sale. It's a gift. Amen. You have neither part nor lot in this matter. The word there, matter, is actually the Greek word logos, which means word or speech. Amen. Isn't that interesting? The Holy Ghost, that logos, and that the words that is given, the speech. Amen. For your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of your wickedness and pray God if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven. Amen. The remedy for the heart is still Jesus Christ.
Amen. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Amen. The remedy for every heart, amen, is Jesus Christ. Amen. God can do a work in each and every heart. Amen. I'm very cautious very cautious. I know counseling has its place, but we need to be careful what type of counselors we fool with. We need to be careful what we look to for answers. Some time ago, it was very evident to me that some folks had talked, and I'm not going to be able to think about the word now because I didn't write it down, of a certain type of counseling, whether led in the light. Be careful. Only allow God to lead you in directions. Amen. The enemy can come as an angel of light. Only God can fix our hearts. Only God can fix the heart. Peter said, "For I perceive." Thank God for the Holy Ghost that helps us perceive. Amen. Every one of us, our perception can be changed. Our hearts can be changed. It can be led by the Holy Ghost. He said that you are on the gall of bitterness, extreme wickedness, and the bond of iniquity. And because of that greed for money, then answered Simon and said, "Pray ye to the Lord for me." Isn't it good when you see folks and I'm not out to pray for me? Pray for me. I need God in this situation. Folks, the only thing that can change us is, oh God, pray for me. God, I need you to pray for ourselves. Amen. God, I need you to fix it. I need you to change me. The Bible says that none of these things which you have spoken come upon me. Amen. And they, when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, returned to Jerusalem and preached the gospel in many villages of Samaria. I love the next part of the chapter where we look at Philip. It's amazing to me that the book of Acts really isn't full of superstar preachers. It's not. It's full of ordinary Christians who go everywhere the Spirit of God leads them to go and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can I say that one more time? Because I think it's important. The book of Acts is not full of superstar preachers. They're full of ordinary people who are open to the leading of the Holy Ghost and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And I need to say this, that really we look, and so far as we've been studying the book of Acts, out of seven of these deacons who've been appointed, we see two of them doing great things. We see Stephen as he has a right spirit and a wisdom, and he stands for righteousness, and we see the Spirit of God moving in his life. And now we're looking at Philip and his life. Just a deacon. I'm not talking about one of the apostles. I'm talking about just some ordinary folks who God chooses, and the Spirit of God leads them. And as they preach the gospel, they see God work and move in their lives, and other lives are transformed. Folks, I want to tell you that's a challenge us tonight, because that's you and I. Amen. We don't need to be superstar preachers. Amen. What we need to be is individuals who are led by the Spirit of God and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ that can transform a life. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's powerful tonight. Amen. It changes lives. Amen. When we're led by the Spirit and we share the gospel, amen, it'll transform the lives of others. Amen. Sometimes don't wonder alone, why am I at this job? Or God, why? Amen. Know that when we are open to the Spirit of God, amen, as God leads us, it's an opportunity to share the gospel with folks that may never hear the message of salvation. Otherwise, there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Amen. Preach it. Amen. They need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then here's folks, and I believe that they were good folks, and they knew about the Old Testament, but they had not accepted the Messiah. They didn't accept Jesus Christ. And here are individuals under the influence of the Holy Ghost. They go and they preach the gospel. The Bible says, "And the angel of the Lord spoke unto Philip." Amen. Here's another mission. Amen. He's saying, "Arise, go toward the south, unto the way that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza, which is desert." Here it is. He's going about 100 miles, I believe it is. The Bible says, "And he rose and went the distance of about 100 miles, and he beheld an Ethiopian You know, 100 miles to us probably isn't a whole lot when we think about getting in our vehicle and driving. And we can do that in a length of time and drive back to the same. It wasn't that way, Daniel, for Philip. But as the Spirit of God said, go, there are times where maybe he felt tired like we feel tired. But God said, I want you to go. I have something for you. So he goes. And the Bible says, he arose and he went immediately. There was no hesitation. The Bible says, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. Here it is, one of the most amazing things that I love about the gospel. Does anyone know what this is the first of? Who is this Ethiopian? He's very similar to us. He's a Gentile. Here is the first proselyting of the Gentiles. It's amazing as we look. You know, it seemed like maybe for whatever reason there wasn't that reaching out to the Gentiles. For whatever that may have been, maybe they had the mindset, amen, we're the Jewish believers. Maybe they were trying to keep the church clean. Maybe they were trying to, you know, just, well, we'll keep it here. Amen. But God said the gospel goes to everyone. Hallelujah. Amen. That is so encouraging tonight for us to think about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's powerful enough to go to everybody. Amen. To the harlot down in the street corner, to the drug addict, to the drunk, to the one, amen, who doesn't believe in himself and doesn't take care of himself. The gospel of Jesus Christ is life-changing. God loves souls. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. And here it is. Then he goes to this Ethiopian, amen, and he was in charge of our treasure. He was a treasurer of an African country, and the Bible says that he had come to Jerusalem to worship, probably the Feast of the Tabernacles, and there in October. And as he was returning back to Ethiopia, the Bible says, that here it was that he was sitting in his chariot and he was reading the gospel of Isaiah. Amen. I love it. We'll talk more about it in a few moments. We'll turn there. If you want to turn there to Isaiah 53, you can do that. Put your finger there. And as he was reading there, the Bible says, the Spirit, amen, said unto Philip, aren't you glad that the Holy Ghost talks to us? Aren't you glad that the Holy Spirit can speak to us? You know that little nudge you feel inside sometimes? Amen. Thank God for the Spirit of God.
Yes.
He speaks. So here it is. He's speaking to Philip. And I want you to know that God desires to guide us in everything about our lives. Amen. Here it is in his everyday life, Brother Eli. The Spirit of God nudged him and spoke to him. Said, this is what I want you to do, Philip. Amen. I want you to go near to this this chariot. I want you to join yourself, amen, with the chariot. And the Bible says that Philip, he sat down and he hesitated.
Wow.
He ran.
Yes.
He ran, the Bible says. And he heard him read of the prophet of Isaiah. Amen. He's reading there aloud. And he said, do you understand what you're reading? Thank God for preachers. Thank God for individuals who are led by the Spirit. Amen. I'm not talking about pastors. I'm talking about preachers. Each one of us are preachers. Amen. Those of us that the Spirit of God has enlightened our eyes to the Word of God. Amen. Being enlightened to the things of God is so important. We'll read in the next chapter about Paul's experience on the road to Damascus and his enlightenment by the Spirit of God. Thank God. Amen. That God, amen, regenerates us. I said already on Sunday morning, as I was preaching Jehoshaphat. Oh, I can't really get that out of my mind. Jehoshaphat, desiring to hear from God. Amen. There's something about being a Christian that we can be open to the Spirit of God and knowing what God has for us and the Word of God speaks to us. Brother David, the unregenerated heart and mind can't understand it. Amen. But for us, Brother Josh, who've been saved by the grace of Jesus Christ, amen, the Spirit of God makes it real to us, Brother Craig. We can understand it. Amen. Logic doesn't understand it, but the Spirit of God makes it real. So here it is that he's reading, And the Bible says that the eunuch, he says, how can I accept a man guide me? Amen. I need someone to help me. And he desired Philip that he would come and he would sit with him. Oh, thank God. I like the approach that we can take just a little scripture here. Just plain scripture. I don't need the hoopla of stories and illustrations always. Thank God for a little bit of help at times. We just need the word of God. Just God's word. Amen. And he desired that Philip would sit with him. Explain these scriptures to me. And the place of the scriptures which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter on the land before her shears, and he opened not his mouth. Oh. His humiliation, his judgment, he was taken away. Who shall declare his generation? You know what the Sanhedrin? Do you know what they wanted to do? Sister Rachel, they wanted to annihilate this son. Sister Rachel, let's just wash him out of the picture of history. Brother Justin, let's get him away. So they had him crucified. This lamb that was led to the slaughter. Who's he talking about? It's Isaiah. Prophesying about Jesus Christ. For his life was taken from earth. Oh, the devil had evil intentions, but God had a great plan. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, whom speaks the prophet? I love when folks get hungry for God. When they listen to me. Who is the prophet speaking about? Of himself or of another man? How the right question is answered. Philip, he opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Would someone read Isaiah 53, verse number 7 and 8? Amen. Let's just look at the correlation, what's happening here.
He is oppressed and he is afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people. Was he stricken?
Jesus. Thank God for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
He was led as a lamb. He opened God's mouth. Who's going to declare his generation? He tried to get rid of him. He tried to wipe him out of history. But let me tell you, you can't get rid of God. Oh, let me tell you, I'll preach that generation. I'll preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'll tell you who he is. He's God. He's the Son of God. His name is Emmanuel, God with us. His name is Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Yeah, let me tell you about Philip. Let me tell you about the Messiah. And all of a sudden, this Gentile, amen, he's birthed into something that is so great that of every nation, every tribe, amen, Jesus came to save. Hallelujah, he preaches the gospel to him. And the Bible says in verse number 35, Philip opened his mouth and he began to the same scripture and he preached unto him, Jesus, thank you, Lord. And as they went on their way, they came to a certain water. Hallelujah. It must have been such a conversation there, Brother Craig. Preaching so often, Brother Justin, is never done behind the pulpit. We'll never reach a lot of sinners. Amen. But Sister Dietrich, as we share the gospel, and I am so convinced, Brother Josh, that God prepares people's hearts for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I believe that there are hungry people out there who want to know, God, let me be led by the Spirit. Let me be directed that I may share the gospel with them, Brother David. Hallelujah. And so here it is. Amen. How timely it is. The Bible says that the eunuch saw that there was water there. And he said, what hinders me from being baptized? Amen. It was evident that he had accepted Jesus. Amen. Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, amen, that's what we need to do. Amen. That's what salvation is, believing and making that confession. And he answered, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Amen. That is the answer to the gospel. Believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The Bible says that that Ethiopian, he commanded the chariot to stand still. And he and Philip, he got out of the chariot. They went down and he was baptized. Amen. Here it is that they both went down into the water. I said to you last week, we were having baptism on Sunday night. I just appreciated the Lord, the Spirit of God that I felt there. Amen. It was great. It was emotional. I felt the emotion. And the Spirit of God, as both Brother Rick and Sister Linda testified to what God had done in their life. Brother Rick had said, and I don't even remember that I said this on Sunday morning. Really. He said, I wasn't planning on getting baptized. He asked me Sunday after church. He said, would I mess your program up if I got baptized tonight? And we talked a little bit. He said, you're not going to mess my program up. You want men, you want God in. He said, there was just something about Sunday morning. He had said, were about children, if they got baptized when they were little and they said sprinkling and that the immersion of water, he said, I realized I'm a saved man now. I thought that all baptism was good enough. He said, but I know. Amen. You gotta know that you know what you know. Baptism is important. Baptism in water. The Bible says, and they both went down into. Here it is that they went down into the water. And it was that evidence that they were buried with Christ in his death, resurrected in the newness of life, as they were both in the water. And I believe that the Bible is immersion. There must first of all be a knowledge of salvation on the part of the individual that is getting baptized. You know, as much as, boy, if I can make a choice for anyone here, I choose for you to be saved. Because I realize how important that is. But I can only choose for me. And I realize that I look at some of you parents in here, I know you're doing the best you can to raise your children for the Lord. That's a blessing to me. You model Christ in that for me. Thank you. But I know that, you know, there'll come a day when each one of these young people have to come to an experience with Jesus Christ for himself. Then they'll ask to be baptized. It's so important they know about that experience. Amen. Thank God for a lot of baptism. Amen. And when they were come up out of the water, the Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away. And that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. I want you to think about that. What would that be like? What would that have been like on Sunday night if after we baptized Brother Rick and Sister Linda, that the Spirit of God just picked me up and moved me on to the next one? That'd been pretty amazing, right? Yeah. That's what happened. The Spirit of the Lord just picked up Philip and moved him on. The Bible says that as he moved him on, he began to preach until he came to Caesarea. I'm going to begin chapter number 9. I'm not going to go far into the chapter because of the sake of time. But in chapter number 9, the Bible says, "And Saul yet breathing out threatenings and slaughterings against the disciples of the Lord." Boy, he was quite the character, wasn't he? Oh, how I love when God gets a hold of those who are rebelling against him. Here was that he went to the high priest. Could be Caiaphas. We don't know. And desired of him, probably was Caiaphas, desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues. But if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, they might be brought bound into Jerusalem. He did not like the message of Jesus Christ crucified and risen being preached. He went against everything of his scholarly way. And he journeyed and he came near to Damascus. He had a hike about 175 miles from Jerusalem. And suddenly there shined around him a light from heaven. Amen. The glory of God. Amen. And he fell to the earth. God's power has the power to knock us down, doesn't it? Amen. I believe God still moves in the Holy Ghost. Amen. In church service, amen, he comes by, he might just knock you down and minister to you. That'd be alright? It's alright. And he heard a voice say unto him, Saul, why persecutest me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? He knew he was, wasn't he? Didn't he? He said, Who are you, Lord? Referring to the deity of God. And he heard the voice that he was Jesus. And that name Paul hated. He did not like the name of Jesus. He said, It's hard for you to kick against the pricks, meaning that goat that if the oxen kicked against it, was just more painful. How many of you have ever found out when God gets moving in your life and you begin to kick against it, it's just more painful? Any of you ever been there? God, I don't want to do that. You kick against it, it's more painful. You might as well just surrender to the Lord. Save yourself a little bit of pain. And trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what will you have me to do? Told him to arise and go into the city, and it would be told him what he must do. Wow. Paul's about to get a message like he's never heard. Sister Rachel, God's about to say, Go. You're about to change the world. You're about to change the course of the world. You're about to give instruction, but adjusting. That will change the world forever because you're going to be an influential man in the church. Who would have ever thought through shipwrecks, through beatings, through sickness, through imprisonments, that his epistles, Brother Josh, would still be his direction? And the men which joined him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. They didn't get let in on what Paul was let in on. And when he arose from the earth and his eyes were open, he saw no man. The glory of God had blinded him. He led him by hand, brought him to Damascus, and he was there 3 days without sight. Now it's interesting that he was there without physical sight, but spiritually it seemed like he had never seen before. I wonder what God does. Amen. In the middle of what we see to be disaster, God helps us to see things more clearly. The Bible says that he did not eat or drink those 3 days and nights. And then a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, he's a follower of Christ. And the Lord said to Ananias in a vision, "Behold,